happen nowadays is very fortunate to, since they call it their baby project. So every the round of cycles that they have around the FSM, we're on the list to do any project that we want. So I know last year they were in Kusaya, right? Or in Yap, we're in Yap, the CCA team. So that's the same team that are going around the island that did the project in the library. So that library is their favorite project. It's not on their list, but you know, every time they come here, they visit the library to see what we need for a small project that we need, and then they will include that in their project. And then in 1988, February, the first, it was first opened to the public with 10,000 volumes of books. And then they will start with volunteer. And then after a few years, in 1989, and there was an agreement between the Bombay State and the Friends of the Bombay Public Library to have the library like owned by the Bombay State, and they will start providing funds for the library to pay the staff. So that was in 1989 that the first paid staff started funded. The library was started with a small room, just one section. But then in 1995, we were fortunate to have the same team, you know, they came and put another section that we call it the Place of Enlightenment. That's the children's section. So that's another section that's added to the library. And in 1999, that's the first grant that we received from the Australian Embassy that purchased 5 computers. And I believe that time CLM was also working with the libraries, so we were able to get the pallet to hook up in our libraries. That's the first pallet. So that's the first automated system that we used, the VALI. And then in 2000, a grant was received from the Embassy of Japan to get 3 computers with internet subscription for 1 year. And that lady over there, I know some of you know her, she's a former librarian. Carmina Levi, getting the grant from the Japan ambassador during that time. Okay, then in 2002, we did receive a bookmobile fan from the Bank of Wisdom. It was a used truck fan that we used, but then, you know, we were dealing with some mechanical problem with the cars, and we spent so much on that car itself, so we decided to stop using that motel. And then in that same year, we received 7 computers from the Bill Gates Foundation. I believe not only us during the time, the analyst when it came during the time is for all the FSM states, so I believe some of you also received some computers from the Bill Gates Foundation. And then in 2003, we received a grant of $7,400 from the USDA, at the, what we call Farmers Home here in Manila, for tiling and expanding the computer lab that we have today. And in 2005, the internet upgraded is when we first hook up. During that time, when we first hooked up to the internet, we were using T1 line. I don't know if you still remember that connection. It's T1 line. It's an old, it's the first connection that came to Bombay is T1 line. So after that, we were able to upgrade to 2005 to ADSL. And ADSL during that time, it was not through the fiber optic that we have right now. Right now it's very fast because of the fiber optic. It's the ADSL only, it's like the satellite. And then in 2007, we received a grant from Australia. You know, we're very fortunate to, you know, receive grants from, but it's because, you know, most of our supporters and, you know, people that come into the library, you know, they see that these people are using these libraries, so they were, you know, really willing to help the library to grow. In 2007, we also received another grant from Australia Embassy to, for technology upgrade. And then in 2009, we did receive a donation from VBAC. I know most of you are familiar with VBAC. VBAC is the Richard Pacific, the state radio station in Hawaii. And the head of the team is Claire Mokai, and most of you also know him because he's been in some of the Bialas. And we were able to replace all our wooden shelves to metal shelves. So we're free from termites. Not the books, but the shelves. And in 2010, we received three computers from Juan Rotary Club with printers. And then in 2010, we again received a grant from the Australian Embassy. And that grant was used to purchase computers. I remember it was one laptop and three or four desktop. With the new Follett that we are using right now, it's the 11.1. I don't know if it's called, it's Follett, but when it came, it has a different name, Library Destiny. And that's what we use. It's like a web browser, web-based browser. It's been set up like a web page. So you, yeah, it's the one we're using right now. And then in 2011, the CAT team came and they did a big renovation of the library to change the ceilings all the way from ceilings up to the roof. And then in 2012, we received a playground equipment from the mainland. This donation was from My International. My International, I don't know if you have in the other state, but we have it here in Pompey. It's an NGO that, you know, did a lot of activities in helping the schools and libraries here. So they did give us that playground equipment, and the shipping cost and the shipping cost was contributed by the Australian Embassy and the Pompey Rotary Club. And then in 2014, we have the Chinese Embassy donate six computers. We have six computers in the computer lab. They're from Chinese Embassy. And then in 2007, just this year, last month, we were able to get a security camera installed in the library. Because we were thinking to get like a security alarm on the door to, you know, protect from people, you know, walking with the books out without our notice. But it's kind of expensive, so we worked with the same team, the Mai, and they were able to get us a security camera that, you know, that we can stay in the office and see what's going on inside the rooms and also outside. That's the first part of my presentation. You have any question before I go on the second one? The staff, please help me with that. Visitors for one day.
I'm
is the only public library on island, and it's right in the middle of where the schools are. You know, Pix High School is up there. We have some school around the, so it's like right in the middle. You know, after school, that's when we receive all these kids. You know, and I think you know they, some they come to cool off, and then you know still you know they cool off. You know, they have something to do that they get books made. That's one of our dreams, but you know that thing is very hard to find. But we really want to get a separate Pacific room, to have you know those Pacific collection in there, separate from our collection. But we've been trying so hard to work with that with our local leaders, but the problem is the money. And you know if we have to get those kind of grant, it has to be a big amount of grant. And we're dreaming of that, and we are also trying. The bookmobile is we have the books in the van, and then we drive out to the schools to have the kids access to our collection. You know, they apply for same as what the kids are doing here. They come inside the bookmobile, apply for a membership card, and then they start checking out the books. And then we have to revisit them, you know, like every other week to have them return and then check out some more.
What's so special about the public library at this day? I saw people outside the gate when it's closed. Looks like they're sleeping in their car there.
Library is, if you drive around, it's like almost 24/7, you see people outside our gate. We have a free Wi-Fi that was donated from Episode Congress, ED1. We have two Wi-Fi there. One is free, and the other one is the public library Wi-Fi that you have to pay $10 a month. But we upgrade that public library, so when you hook up to the one is slow, then you have to pay for that $10.
So that's a good, I just want to bring that up. If your Wi-Fi at your hotel is slow at 2 or anytime, go to the public library, park outside, sleep there and use the internet.
You know the Wi-Fi, it really helps the library, you know, during the night because, you know, it protects from people even trying to come inside the gate during night time because, you know, in the past we have experienced, you know, people coming and trying to break in the library, but nowadays we don't have different things because of the Wi-Fi, people are around, you know, all the time. So. Thank you.
Can you please speak up?
Yeah.
Some Congress, when they gave us that one, they don't allow us to charge people. That's why it's free.
Who funded that?
The Epsom Congress, ED1. ED1 is
So if you're at the airport, there's a free Wi-Fi there at the hospital? Free Wi-Fi, yeah. Public library?
He hooked up some in at the airport, that is ED1. The hospital and the public library, and there were also some place that he also,
Free Wi-Fi at the Epsom Supreme Court Library.
It's not free, but they pay at the Epsom.
Are you visiting the communities or only the schools?
The schools. Yeah. Yeah, but we, you know, when we go to the schools, we also, you know, we, if the community come to us, we're also, you know, willing to help them, if we go to the schools. But our main, spot that we're going at the schools, yeah. Okay. I'll move on to the second part. The second part is our program that we have at the library. So we have a story hour, and it's every Thursday for everyone. It's free, you don't have to pay for that. We have to keep it ongoing, you know, sustainable that we're talking about. We really try to have volunteers, parents, students involved in that. We also have official leaders coming sometimes to present to the kids, read stories to kids. And there you, in the picture, you can see a volunteer, right? The one up there is a student. Is one of the students that, you know, used to come for the story hour, and then, you know, sometimes we ask them if they're willing to read, and so some of them help them read. Sorry, but we can have it every day, but you know, we have other things to do, so it's like short of staff, and we only schedule it for Thursday. But I know it's a very popular one. If we go for it every day, we'll have people, you know, coming, but we need time to do like cataloging, and so that's the only day that we can set up for our story hour. And there are only four of us that are working on it. We also have summer meeting program. I believe also the Kosai, Yap, Juke also have this program. I remember one time I went out to the state using the MLS fund from the FSM archives to try to initiate with the program in the other state. But, you know, in fact, actually when I came to the state, I found out that YAP is already running that summer reading program. So I work with the Kosraian team and also to have the summer reading program during that year. But I know Kosrae is doing that. I'm not sure about Chuk, because I haven't heard any report from them after that. We usually have it mid-June to July. You know, we have it during that time because we want the students, when they get off the school, they have some time to break before the summer, before the summer begins, and then have them register. So it's not mid-June, it's supposed to be mid-July and August. So we have them register the first week of July, and then start the program in the mid-July, and then end in mid-August, to also have time for them to break before the school starts. Registration fee, it depends. You know, sometimes, one time we offer the summer reading program for free, because the grant that we received from the MLS, they gave us the material, so they say that we don't have to charge the kids for the registration fee. But then, other than the MLS that we fund, that we use our own money, we have them pay for $5 for one kid. So for our limit is 100 kids, but sometimes we go beyond that because, you know, we limit that, but then when the school, the summer really begins, the parents, they come and they pay for their kids to attend, so we allow some of the... So we go beyond that, but that number is our limit. The reason why we stick to that number, because the staff, like I said, it's only for staff. So we, the 100 kids, we divided them up into by grades, and then we have them coming Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Monday is our preparation day. Tuesday, we have the first group coming, and then this Wednesday, the other group, and Thursday, the next group. And Friday is our day, we save that day to get the reading log and, you know, record the readings and the books that they have read, so that we can keep track of the numbers, number of books that they read. And the CSLB is the Collaborative Summer Library Program. That's their website. CSLB, we've been part of CSLB for 4 years now, the Everson Group. Erica was the first one who went to the workshop. They have a workshop, annual workshop that they do, that they have in April, before the summer starts. The first one we attended was in Mississippi. Erica was the one that represented Everson. And the three workshops after that, I was the one who went. They were fully funded. You don't have to pay for anything. They pay for your ticket all the way from here to the mainland. The money that you use during your travel, when you come back, you can fill out a claim form to have them reimburse your money. So it's a very good program. When you meet, when we have the meeting, we share the ideas, and, you know, whatever we share, we put into booklet, and then compile them, and then have them, all of us go back to the state, and then the CSLB people will compile those into a booklet, and then send out to all the states that will have the summer reading program. So it makes it easier for us, you know, to run the summer reading program. All the activities and everything is already in the booklet. And with the books that, you know, also books that you need for the team is also on the handout. But they don't provide the books, but you have to pay for the books. To access to the CSLB spread website, you have to have an account. Because they have some very low prices, incentive prices in there that, you know, are really good for the kids, but it's only accessible to the membership. So if you're a member, you can order from them. And to become a member, you can access to the website and then contact them through the website. It's only for public libraries, not school libraries. Those pictures are just from the summer meeting that we had this year, the CSLB meeting. That picture on the bottom, that's the representative from the Pacific region. That's from American Samoa, CNMI, Guam, and Labasan. We still don't have RMI and Palau in there. Okay, Library Week, this is the annual event that we have. We run it in the month of April because that's when the National Library Week is, the National Library Week. So during the Library Week, we have essay and art contest. We send out letters to the schools to have the students compete in these contests, and then submit to us, and then we'll select the winners, and then provide prizes for them. The vendors and volunteers, we always try to have vendors during the Library Week, because there are our supporters for the prizes and the gifts for the kids that we have that are competing in the SCRI. What we do, we send out letters to the vendors. And we're fortunate to, we've been running this for so many years, and it's been known to most of the vendors. So they're almost every year they're put up their donations for this program. During the week, we have a daily presentation for that week. What we do, we ask the agencies in the office, like fire department, environmental agency, to come and, do their presentation to the kids during that week. And it's morning activities. During that week, we invite the kids to, decide the schools that we will invite and send them letters and ask them to come in for the to prepare for the presentations. The involvement of the officials and leaders on the last day, the Friday, that's the closing ceremony. We usually have the ambassadors, the governor, all the leaders to to come in that day to see, because that's when we give out the gifts and prizes for the winners of the kids. So those pictures on front, if you see those kids, with the lasers sitting on front, those were the winners of that year. So the winners sit on the front to get their prizes. And the one on top, that's the it's a illegal drinking awareness from the police department here. So they're doing their presentation to the kids. Okay, we also have a group tour. Group tour, we only allow that in the morning, because that's, we don't want them to come in after school. It's very, it's a rush hour, so we don't want to mix up with the kids that are in the library. We also have a group tour during story hours, when they come in for a special day, and then we get to a group tour and then do the story. And also, during Library Week, if there is no presentation, we can also have a group tour. And on the group tour, that's what we share, the rules and the regulations of the library and our services. And one of the programs that we also have, the Adopt-A-Maxi program, is on our block. That Adopt-A-Maxi program, if you access to our block, on top of our block, you can see Adopt-A-Maxi program. If you click on that, it will show you how it works, how to get a vaccine to return it to the library. We have received so many vaccines for our prisoners from this program. You know, people just click that program and then go down to the drop menu and then fill out the forms and then subscribe.